It's the grandest stage in sports entertainment. With WrestleMania 34 taking place this last Sunday in New Orleans, my wife and I take a look back to our childhood and rewatch WrestleMania 16 from the year 2000. Join us for a hard-hitting episode of The Wreck My Podcast. All right, welcome to another episode of The Wreck, my podcast, where we challenge nostalgia and pop culture and put it to the test and see if it wrecks our perception of it. Tonight, again, we have another husband and wife episode. This is my beautiful wife, Madison.
So sweet.
I am your host, I guess, because I'm always the one talking the most.
Yeah, you're the host.
My name is Jordan. And so tonight we thought we'd go back to something that is nostalgic for both of us.
Yeah.
Actually, nostalgic, but I'm still into it now.
Right.
But something that we bonded over early in our relationship, and that is wrestling.
How
professional
early?
Professional wrestling. What do you mean, how
What's
early?
What's the story of the first time we ever had a wrestling conversation?
When the first day we met.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Tell them the story.
Okay. So when we met, the first night we met was actually at my mom's surprise 50th birthday party.
Yep.
Madison kind of crashed it. She came with another family friend. So you would imagine that a surprise 50th birthday party would be a lot of people that you know.
Sure.
So Madison was probably one of the few people there that we didn't know. So I saw her and I was like, who's this cute girl in the Uggs? I remember she was wearing Uggs. But, you know, I was kind of helping plan the party, so I didn't have too much time to go out and socialize. So later in the evening, when things were finally calming down, I went over and I was talking in a group to people, and Madison was there, and everyone kind of left except for me and you for some reason.
Yeah, I don't
remember why,
yeah.
But everyone left, and then me and you were left, so I was like, I made a joke about Rob Van Dam,
yes.
I think, about like a 5-star frog splash or something about Kane or something like that.
Yeah.
And you got it. You laughed at the joke because at first I said it. I'm like, she's not going to get this. And she laughed at it. I was like, hey, she knows about wrestling. That's awesome. Or she just thinks I'm really, really funny and cute.
No, because I remember saying like, oh my gosh. And like, I used to watch The Undertaker.
Yeah.
Like, I remember
you
said something that made my statement credible.
Exactly. Like you added to the joke I made, and that's how I realized, wow, she knows wrestling.
Right.
So that's when the first time we talked revolved around
wrestling. So it's very like it's come full circle
for sure.
We still talk about it.
And what I found out later, and we've kind of touched on this in another episode that we did together, but your dad was really into wrestling, and still he follows it somewhat. Definitely not to the extent that I follow it right now.
No,
and wrestling is not as I don't want to say interesting, but really not as interesting as it was back in the Attitude Era in the 90s and 80s and everything.
Well, it's much more PC.
It's much more scripted and
predictable.
Predictable. There's a formula to it. Very rarely do they really like
stray from it
or like really something that, because of social media that we're in now, and this is what got me back into it, is I'm actually very interested in the back stage stuff, the industry side of it, like
behind the kayfabe.
Behind the kayfabe, how things are ran, how certain scenarios play in. It's very hard now with social media to surprise the fans because weeks ahead, months ahead, a year ahead, we know what WrestleMania matches are going to be. We know who's holding titles, barring any people going to jail for DUIs, people going to jail for...
Or getting hurt or
something. Yeah, getting hurt, injuries, stuff like that. Yeah, of course. So now it's not as... things that would be considered shoot back in the day. Sorry for using a lot of terms that people don't know. Shoot is non-scripted stuff.
Right.
Things that would be viewed as shoot are still kayfabe and you're not fooling anyone. And kayfabe means in character, pretty much. Scripted is what it is in storyline. So it's hard to get away with that. We're back in the day. I feel like they could do things and make it feel real because kayfabe.
You didn't know.
You didn't know what kayfabe was. There was no way for you to look something up on Google. Like, did that actually happen?
Or it could at least keep you guessing.
Yes.
Like, maybe some people would be convinced one, and then that would be something you could debate then if it was real or not.
Exactly. Water cooler talk for wrestling, which doesn't exist anymore. It's kind of more finite. Like, you can go on Twitter and find out exactly what's going on for most of this stuff.
Yeah.
So anyway, to bring it back around, your dad was into wrestling back
very
in the day.
Much.
So me and him bonded on that, had a lot to talk about. And that was a huge thing in your upbringing.
100%.
As you stated before, your dad didn't care whether his first kid was a son or a daughter. He was going to raise them with the anime, with the wrestling, with the video games, sports, throwing the football around.
Yeah, it was
all
how
that
we
stuff.
Connected and how we bonded.
Exactly. Yeah. So as much as you are a girly girl, you were forced to go into the tomboy realm to connect with your dad growing up.
I mean,
and
not forced. I loved doing it.
But you wanted
it,
to, and you found enjoyment in it. You found you were able to appreciate it. So now, when you found me, your nerdy husband who's into so much like ridiculous pop culture and wrestling and video games and everything.
Yes.
You were we were tailor made for each other.
Yeah. Shout out to my dad for raising me for
Thank
my husband.
Thank you for raising her for me all those years that I didn't know her. So you watched wrestling more back in the Attitude Era because that's when your dad was more into it. So, you know, The Rock, Stone Cold Steve Austin, Mankind,
Undertaker,
Shawn Michaels,
Kane.
Undertaker, Kane. Yeah.
Chris Jericho.
Chris Jericho was in his prime, didn't have his saggy man boobs now.
He doesn't have saggy man boobs.
I always point
boobs.
That out. I'm like,
he looks great.
He looks like he has saggy man boobs. But I love you, Chris Jericho. You're doing great. New Japan, you and Kenny Omega, that was amazing.
I'm the real fan. He's hating.
No, you, believe me, Chris Jericho, you could still beat the crap out of me in my greatest shape ever.
That's true.
Even with your saggy man boobs. So you were more of that era. I started watching it when I was in junior high, seventh grade. So that was 2000. I think between 2000 and 2002 is when I watched. So I didn't watch very long. I watched from essentially one WrestleMania to the following year's SummerSlam after. So a year and a half about. And I got into it because a friend of mine was into it. Actually, someone in our school where I went, their dad was Sting, Mr. Borden. I don't know his first name. We just called him Mr. Borden. But so my one friend got into it because he was friends with Sting's son. And then I was like, hey, cool, I want to see this. And I really got into it also. I was like, oh, these people are beating each other up. And I like the fact that it was staged and fake because at that point, everyone knew it was fake still.
Yeah.
They knew it was scripted. They knew people weren't trying to hurt each other. I didn't like UFC or boxing. So I was like, oh, that's too real for my small child stomach to handle. I like the fact that I could watch something like that and know that for the most part, they're really not trying to hurt each other. A lot of the injuries are fake, stuff like that. The blood's fake.
Storyline.
Back then, the blood was half fake, half real. They were kind of in that transitional period of everything. So I watched it for a very small amount of time back then, but I watched it hardcore. Like, I was into it back then, 100%. Then I took a break for a long time. Even when me and you started dating, I still followed wrestling in the tiniest bit. Like, I would, if I saw an article about a name I knew, John Cena or whatever, I'd keep up with that, but did not watch regularly. I maybe watched a WrestleMania here or there, or I think I watched a SummerSlam because Stephen Amell was on it, and I was a fan of Arrow.
I remember, though, we went to Joe's house once, and we did watch WrestleMania, and that was, like, 2 years before we got into it, really.
Yeah, so fast forward, 2002, I stopped watching. Fast forward to what? It was
2016.
No, 2017.
Was when we watched the WrestleMania.
It was Royal Rumble. So the January of 2017.
No, I'm saying when we first watched.
Oh, you're right. 2016. We watched a WrestleMania, March or April of 2016, and then January of 2017. I started watching a podcast called Going in Raw. Stephen Larson. They are the greatest podcasters ever.
So awesome.
I watched them back in their days at Machinima on 10 for the Win. If you haven't seen 10 for the Win, check that out too. It's all top 10 countdown videos, but they do skits. These two are like the odd couple.
I love them.
Their charisma together and their chemistry is impeccable.
And it's genuine.
It's genuine. I literally watch their podcast sometimes and they go on tangents and they'll be talking about
meatloaf.
Meatloaf or how they like their waffles.
Yes.
Riveting television. Riveting. I love it. I watch them nonstop.
Yeah,
it's great.
They're really good.
I was really into them. Watching them about wrestling, and I wasn't even watching wrestling. I was just watching their recap shows. It's pretty much what I was doing, and it started getting a little interesting. And I was like, these names I'm recognizing. These people sound pretty cool. They're painting this awesome word picture. I think I'm gonna check it out. So Royal Rumble was always one of my favorite matches ever. I love the Royal Rumble. So I was like, January 2017, I'm gonna sign up for WWE Network. Let's check out Royal Rumble, and I'll start watching Raw and SmackDown again. Maybe here and there. We'll see how it goes. Well, I went into it hardcore again.
Oh,
I think Madison's a little annoyed now because I calculate it, and I watch a good like 12 hours of wrestling a week now.
Yeah.
Because I watch Raw on Monday. I watch SmackDown on Tuesday. I watch 205 Live on Tuesday night as well. I watch NXT on Wednesday. Then there is the pay-per-views, which there's a billion pay-per-views.
And you watch the Steven Larson recap.
I watch Steven Larson every day. Yeah. Their recap videos of what I watch.
To be fair, though, like a lot of the stuff, like I know there's been a few times where you haven't gone back and watched episodes. And no. There's also times where you're like listening to it while you're washing dishes. Or like
most
stuff. It's
the
not
time,
always just like you're not doing anything
no,
else.
Almost all the time now. At the beginning, I sat down and watched everything because I still had to learn characters.
Yeah.
I had to learn what storylines you're in, but now I'm at the point where
very rare.
Literally, I maybe sit down for an hour of Raw and watch it, but almost everything I watch wrestling is while I'm doing other things.
Yeah.
I have it on in the background at work, just playing while I'm doing stuff. So I'm barely watching the matches. The only time I think I sit down and really watch a whole show is pay-per-views and good pay-per-views.
Or when we went to Raw.
Or when we went to Raw. Even then, we left early. We didn't even stay for the whole show. So, I mean, that you know, wrestling is cool, but it gets to the point where it's very repetitive. So unless
yes.
you know there's going to be a stellar match between, like, let's say AJ Styles and Shinsuke Nakamura coming up at WrestleMania, going to be an amazing match. Those type of things, you sit down, you watch. For the most part, when you're watching Raw, I'm really just kind of listening to see, like, all right, who's talking about who?
Mm.
Who's turning on who? Who's doing what? What's going on? All right, where's the story going? You don't really need to pay that much attention. And this last week even, our DVR didn't record Raw. I just watched Steven Larson recap 30 minutes out of my life.
Also, I mean, one of the things that kind of gets a little, like, the downside of wrestling, like Raw and SmackDown, is that, I don't know, I mean, this is another thing we'll need to look into, but it's so annoying when they plan this like big thing, like, you know that we're gonna see AJ and Shinsuke, but we also know that for the next 5 weeks leading up to WrestleMania, we're gonna see that same match, and then
yeah.
it's supposed to somehow be surprising and different at the WrestleMania.
Yeah.
But it's not just WrestleMania, it's at any pay-per-view. They
no.
show you the same match.
Yeah, they essentially, it's like they're spinning their wheels for weeks on end, and I understand that it's like building, but honestly,
it's not.
But let's be honest here. What was it where AJ Styles had to fill in last second? What pay-per-view
was
that?
Oh, when he went
that?
To Raw, you
yeah,
mean?
He went to Raw, a Raw pay-per-view
yeah.
to fill in because Roman, no, that was when Kurt Angle filled in. Oh, man, I can't
yeah,
remember.
Yeah, something
now.
Happened,
but
I remember.
AJ had to come in. It was, not Survivor Series. Man, I can't remember now. But he had to fill in week of. He literally did a 30-second Twitter promo, and that was more build that I had seen, better build than half the stuff I've seen, because it does get so boring and repetitive. It's like, stop spinning your wheels.
Yeah,
like,
just give us the match only at the pay-per-view.
We don't need you to say the same thing four different ways week in and week out.
It's not anime.
No.
We can pick it up.
Yeah,
right
seriously.
Away.
Like, I know some people love that, and, you know, older wrestling fans really like that. I'm the young generation, and I'm used to convenience. I'm used to things moving at a faster pace.
Yeah.
I want my season to be 12 episodes, not 24. Like,
yeah.
Let's cut it down. We don't need as much fluff. And that's the problem, is that their creative just has not enough going on that they have to fluff pretty much their A and B storylines because there's nothing else going on.
But I think that'll be interesting, kind of getting back to what we're doing today, is that one of the things that we also tend to not like about pay-per-views is the amount of recaps that they show.
Yeah.
But it'll be interesting to go back to this WrestleMania and see, mm-hmm. do they do the same amount of recaps and kind of see the stuff that we don't like now? Did they always do it and we just didn't realize
yeah.
it?
Well, it also begs the question, are those promos and recaps before matches for replay value? Because I hope they do. I'm not going to remember any of these storylines going back. And we're going to go back and watch WrestleMania 16, which
but
took
then,
place
like,
in the year 2000.
Insert them in the DVDs. Don't show them on the actual pay-per-views
yeah,
for
but,
people who are avid watchers.
I
get
know.
On WrestleMania, you're probably going to get a large viewing that aren't
casuals.
Yeah, they're not just tuning in on a regular basis.
But for the most part, like probably 80% of people tuning into this pay-per-view have been following the storyline. We get it. And I understand there's some of them that actually are really well done. They do the promo videos,
yeah.
the recaps, where it's like, that was epic. I don't remember that build being that epic.
Yeah.
But for the most part, you're kind of like, all right, Where's that skip button? But where's if that fast
80%
button?
Of your fan base is avid watchers, mm-hmm. and say 20% are only checking in, do you really want to cater your show to the 20%, or do you want to choose it to the 80 of well, your loyal people that
I
are
mean,
coming
those
in?
Are arbitrary numbers I'm throwing around. I know, I don't know I'm what saying, their actual think, analytics are.
I personally think it would be the same. Yeah. I think there's a lot more people than are just.
Yeah.
We're getting off topic.
We're getting off topic. But anyway, we're watching WrestleMania 16 tonight. Yes. It's going to be our reminisce. It's going to be a little bit of best of both worlds. It's the tail end of the Attitude Era.
Yep.
Year 2000. Has a lot of the big names that we knew back in the day, but also more of the big names now kind of up and coming.
Yeah.
So it'll be nice because that was the time you were watching. That's the time I was watching. We know kind of what's going on a little bit. We'll maybe remember some stuff. But yeah. Essentially what we're going to do is we're going to go back and we're going to watch it. We're going to compare and contrast to the mass amounts of viewing that we've done over the past year and a half. Or no, it's only been a year and a month, pretty much, year and 2 months of how they do it now compared to how it was done back in the Attitude Era.
Yeah.
So we're going to check that out. We'll give you then a play-by-play of what matches, any big spots that happened, cool story development, and anything.
Big comparison.
Yeah, comparison. And then anything that maybe kind of ruined it for us or things that we think they did better, pretty much.
Yeah.
So this will be a little bit of a bigger break, but you guys won't realize that because
the
we're
power
gonna cut,
of editing.
We're going to cut right to after we watch it. So we'll be back in, what, 4 or 5 hours our time, 30 seconds your time?
Sounds good.
All right.
Those two men put a smile on her face. King, I'm sure you're envious of that. This should be an amazing offensive display. And the first ever triangle ladder match. Paige and Christian are the new champions. First lady to throw her opponent to the floor will win this matchup.
Moolah, pull the cat out of the ring.
Terry has won the match. Six-person tag action.
Kinda cools off the Latino heat.
Tombstone. Paige got his retribution. There's Pete Rose.
Well, as you can see, we were joking around that we'll see you in 3 hours, but as we're wearing different clothes and it's light outside now,
it's been a day.
We obviously waited till the next day to do this. We underestimated how long the WrestleMania was and how late it was when we started it. In fact, I don't think you made it through the whole thing. I think you fell asleep.
I made it through like half.
I think you made it through a little bit more than half. I think that it was like the match before the main event and the main event is you kind of nodded
I
off.
I remember
during.
Being in and out on the main event.
And to be honest, I was struggling to stay awake for, I mean, the main event was probably one of the best matches, but even by that point, I was just so like done.
Yeah. We're an old married couple.
Yeah,
what can
obviously
you expect?
We're an old married couple. But so let's start off then with the first thing we noticed. Well, you want to start off with, do you think this wrecked your perception of it?
100%.
Yeah, I agree. There were some things where I was like, oh, it's cool that it feels more raw, pun intended. And everything, but it felt sloppy.
Yeah.
I didn't like that. I think we've gotten too used to this polished production that
well,
we see now.
And I think too, when you grow up with it, you have the nostalgia, like you remember all the cool parts. And then when you go back, you're like, wow, like
there's
it really wasn't that.
Well, there's a
good.
Lot of really boring filler that has no point being there now. Like you go back and you go, I remember this one was one match, or I remember this feud, but then there's 90% of the show around it where you're like, yeah, these are just B stories, C storylines that no one could care about anymore, with some wrestlers that were maybe there a year or two and then faded out to time.
Yeah.
Never heard of again.
And I think like today, there are some awesome matches. Mm-hmm. Like the one that I always go back to is the Chris Jericho versus Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania. Like I've watched that back a lot of times and it never, doesn't live up to it.
Passing
of
the torch between two people,
this whole WrestleMania, it was pretty lackluster.
Well, I think we made a mistake in deciding to go the year 2000. I think that I could tell this card probably wasn't too stellar.
Yeah.
It still had some big names, but Steve Austin was nowhere to be found.
Yeah, and he
didn't
so
have
good.
A match. He didn't come out. He didn't do anything.
Maybe he'd go back earlier.
Yeah, or a little bit later even, maybe. Yeah. I don't know, one way or the other. But anyway, let's start off. So they started off with the national anthem, which we both were kind of like, do they even do the national anthem anymore? Like,
I don't remember.
I guess we just don't pay
that.
Attention at the beginning. I'm sure they still do it at WrestleMania, but I don't think on any of the other pay-per-views they do it.
No.
Maybe live.
Maybe.
But I don't think, did they do it? They didn't do it for the Raw we went
no.
to.
No. Well, you think because it's a sporting event that they do it because.
And obviously they don't do it all the time.
Yeah, no.
So it took place in Anaheim. Like we said, WrestleMania 16, the year 2000 in Anaheim. It was at the Pond, which is funny because now WrestleMania is so big, they don't do it in indoor arenas anymore.
No.
They have to do it in outdoor arenas to accommodate
like
the
football
amount,
stadiums.
Yeah, the amount of people that go to it. So this was still like in the Pond. It was weird seeing it in because normally you can tell WrestleMania now by, hey, it's outdoors.
Right.
That sets it apart from all the other pay-per-views and all the other shows. So that was interesting. And then another two more things we noticed right off the bat, pyro.
Oh my gosh.
Lots
Epic.
More pyro. Just Epic. Like even in 2000, I noticed they were cutting back on some of them. Like the Dudley Boys didn't have pyro when they came out. But for the most part, there was pyrotechnics on a lot of the entrances. And at the very beginning, they had fireworks.
And even like, I know the biggest pyro was definitely at the beginning when they first kick off WrestleMania. But, you know, like you said, when the Dudley Boys came out, they didn't have it. But when Chyna came out, she had like a gun of pyro. So I'm like, they definitely had some production
people got
into it. Yeah, for sure.
Some people got it. But then the other thing we noticed is there's way more signs. Like,
yes.
People, every single person brought a sign. And they weren't good. Most of them were really crappy looking signs, which I guess is the difference now where people really only bring signs now if it's funny or if it's like very artistically done.
I feel like it was a part of the experience back then. Like when you got your ticket, like what's our sign going to be? Yeah. And like when we went to Raw this year, we thought the same thing, but it's because we kind of grew up in that era. Like we were so shocked, not only watching it on a weekly basis, but actually being there, that there was really
so
not
signs.
A lot of signs.
Like we had to bring one because it was our first Wrestle or our first Raw
together. Yeah.
And we're like, we both really wanted to make a sign, but
do you want to tell them what our sign was?
So it was during the time when The Miz and Dean Ambrose were having a feud. I think the Intercontinental title is what
something
they're feuding
like
over.
That.
And Dean Ambrose wore like a bear suit and came out like the week before we went. So we brought a sign that said The Miz can't bear Dean Ambrose, but it had like the bear like
it
suit
was so cool
and everything. It was kind of like we were trying to do something about The Miz because
we both love the Miz. Yeah.
And we were trying to do something kind of funny so that it might get some screen time because we weren't on the floor level, but we weren't very far up. We were like eye level with pretty much the ring.
Yeah.
And we weren't far back. Mm-hmm. So we were close enough that the camera could have gotten us. Many times they panned into the crowd and we were like, hey, we're in that area.
Yeah.
Couldn't really pull us out of the crowd, but we knew we were in that area.
Right.
So we were trying to do something kind of funny, but we didn't get on the thing.
Still part of the experience.
It was a terrible week for The Miz, unfortunately. He had LeVar Ball, whatever. The guy who was like a football player whose son was on the Lakers that year. And because we were at the Staples Center, they were doing Lakers things and it was really weird and awkward and completely went off the rails and was kind of funny, but you could also tell The Miz, I think, was a little frustrated that the guests he had on were kind of just like saying whatever they wanted to and doing whatever they want to, and they kind of had to improv and it really was messy, but
it wasn't good.
Anyway, show starts off. We have The Godfather and D'Lo Brown coming out to fight against Big Boss Man and Bull Buchanan, and Ice-T came out with Godfather doing a little like rap about pimps and hoes and
which
stuff.
I mean, not to be like so obvious, but wow, how far the women's division has
come from these women
who have like 6-inch heels and no clothing being called pimps and hoes and the whole crowd cheering them on to now the women's division being like the thing that people go in and watch
because like I don't think there was a women's match. I think the only other women's
match
was a cat fight
oh it was
between
bad.
Two people I'd never heard of who who were just like
and they pretty much just like made out with the ref and tore each other's clothes off. Like, no wonder I wasn't allowed to watch that when I was younger.
We'll get to that. I mean, technically China had a match too, but it was a six person tag team match, so it wasn't just her. So Ice-T comes out, does this intro for the Godfather. Godfather and D'Lo Brown come out with fight Big Boss Man, Bull Buchanan. All the hoes are out there, or the pimps are, or no, they were called the hoes. I think.
He's the pimp. They're the hoes.
Yeah, exactly. And then so Bull Buchanan beats I forget if he pinned Godfather or D'Lo Brown, but he wins essentially with a top rope leg drop. Really boring match right off the bat. What I thought was, wow, the choreography. Mm-hmm. I was saying that word wrong all day.
Yeah, you got it.
The choreography was way less polished and it felt so much less organized.
Yeah.
Every match had that feeling where spots were consistently missed. Things were botched left and right. Like I said, it's more of a raw feel, but it feels, I can understand why people thought like, wow, it's fake and it's stupid, because yeah, it was blatantly fake, where now you know it's fake, but it's like a dance. The way these people move and the way they land spots and stuff, it's art. It's like it takes more than just weightlifting, like gymnastics and all that. Like, a lot of strength goes into it, which I kind of like more, honestly.
I feel like it's kind of the thing, like the reason it kind of wrecked my is because back in the day, you didn't know any better. Like, you didn't know what you were missing. Like, this was, the 90s was way better than the 80s or the 70s or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, they were perfecting it and getting it better. But now we have this whole other level 18 years later. And it's like, yeah, when you go back and compare, of course, it's not going to match up.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's the best that they had. And there is something nostalgic about it still. But when you're used to the level that you get now, it's really hard.
Yeah, it's like watching a movie that was made this year and then going back and watching an 80s movie. You can tell most of them don't hold up.
Yeah.
And it's the same way. You go back and you go, all right, for its time, I get it, but it's not holding up right now.
Right.
And that's essentially how most of this show went.
Yeah.
So next we get a Stephanie McMahon and Triple H promo. So essentially the main event was this whole big feud between the McMahon family. Every member endorsed a different person.
Including the mom, which I do not remember.
Linda McMahon, Vince McMahon, Shane McMahon, Stephanie McMahon. Mm-hmm. Each person endorsed a different wrestler to go into this four-way fatal match. No DQ at the end. So this was the first promo we got. Stephanie McMahon, Triple H, because Triple H was the WWF champion.
Mm-hmm.
So he was defending, and him and Stephanie had just gotten married or something like that.
Oh, they look so young.
So young. And I don't know where the bad blood started or what was going on, but there's bad blood between every McMahon family member. So that's where we start. Next, we have the Battle Royal with 15 people, I think, for the Hardcore Championship. Crash Holly was the Hardcore Champion going into it. The Battle Royal had a 15-minute time limit. It was a no DQ, false count anywhere. The title could change hands as many times as possible in that 15 minutes. But at the end of the 15 minutes, whoever pinned last for the title or submitted last for the title, they get it.
Yeah.
So we go into it. It was a lot of people that I really didn't know. But like Farouk and Bradshaw were there. Taz was there. And then there were these people called the Headbangers, which I don't remember at all. But they were wearing like giant padded bras. They were both dudes wearing padded bras with like runny makeup, and like it was very weird. I was like, I want to know more about these guys. Like,
well, the gimmicks back then were a lot more intense and in your face.
It was so weird. But anyway, so it was kind of weird because they didn't really explain the rules of this match either. They explained it as they went on, with like the commentators kind of explaining what's going on, and you just kind of figuring out like, oh, okay, it's no DQ because they're all beating each other up, and it's a hardcore title, so of course. But then like, oh, false count anywhere, I guess, because this person just got pinned outside the ring. So I went back and forth. A few people won the title. About halfway through, Funaki wins the title. And finally, the first smart guy in the whole match, because from the beginning, I was like, if you win, just run away, keep running, don't stop, get as far away as possible, because at 15 minutes are up, you have the title. So Funaki runs up the ramp, goes backstage, but of course they catch up to him. They start then having a brawl behind stage in the belly of the beast of the stadium and everything. it gets changed. The title changes hands probably 12 times.
Brought up the question for us, like, because the cool thing about it is that people who maybe wouldn't have ever got a chance to hold that title get to do it because, you know, the WWE doesn't actually have to then have them hold the title. But then we were saying, does it show then in their career and in their records that they were a champion?
Which I think it does, because every time someone pinned for the title, the ring announcer then said, the new WWF hardcore champion is like Taz. And then when the next person, they did it again. So
even if they only got it for 5 minutes, they got it.
So it'll probably show one day they held the title. It probably won't get as
recognition.
Well, it probably won't get as crazy as like 30 seconds you held the title. Right. I think they'll say like one day. But so that's kind of cool that some of these like lower card people actually got to hold the title then without having to do too much.
And another thing that I loved about the match was what I do remember about watching it when I was a kid is that they were never just confined to the ring. Like, really the most that we see right now is that maybe they go out in the crowd every once in a while, but not like that they're back in the production vans and like doing all this stuff. Like, it's very rare that they do that, where it seems like I remember it being a weekly thing.
Yeah, and normally it's like pre-produced film sometimes now and stuff. Like I said, way more production value goes into it in this day and age. But essentially, we get to the very end. It's kind of a botched Dusty finish. And for those of you that don't know, Dusty finish just means it's inconclusive. Like, it's kind of janky. Essentially, Crash Holly, I think something happened. Crash Holly. So I think that Crash Holly had the title. There were like 10 seconds left. Hardcore Holly, his cousin, I don't know if that's true. I think it is, because they look very similar. Mm-hmm. They look a lot alike. Comes in, smashes something over his head. It was a jar of Snickers that JR had at the announce table, which is really funny. But smashes it over his head. There's 4 seconds left. Pins him. 1, 2, 3. 1 second left. Crash Holly. But the announcers start making all this
comments about his shoulder.
About like, oh, did he get his shoulder up? Like, did you see him get his shoulder up? The ref didn't see.
Which it did
they
not
make
look
the replay.
Like,
he didn't get his shoulder up. He literally, his arm was like the smallest little spasm. Both shoulders firmly still on the ground. I think it was supposed to be like
something more dramatic.
Something more dramatic, where like the shoulder kind of got up, and not really. It's kind of like when they do Royal Rumbles and both people fall out and their feet hit at the same time. But it was just completely botched. So there was supposed to be drama there, but the drama felt really forced. And I was like, guys, come on. You can't even save this one.
That's kind of what the commentators do. I mean, Jordan and I always joke around that they'll like tap their neck and they'll be like, oh my gosh, his neck is broken.
Yeah.
How can he do it? I'm like, that's part of the fun too, is how dramatic
you,
they are.
You learn more of the story from the commentators than you do from watching the match sometimes.
Exactly.
So next, Hardcore Holly leaves with the title. Next, we have Al Snow and Steve Blackman, TNA, with Trish Stratus, or I'm sorry, no, TNA is Testin Albert. So Al Snow, dude with the head, and a guy named Steve Blackman come out, and they are going against TNA. That's Testin Albert, and they come out with Trish Stratus. So Testin Albert win. I don't remember who pinned who. Really boring match. Pointless.
That was bad.
But for some reason, at the end of the match, Al Snow calls out this like dude in a cheese suit.
Yeah, that was so weird.
It was weird, dancing around, and then Steve Blackman beats him up. And I'm like, what the heck is going on? Why are they beating up this poor dude in a cheese suit? I don't know. Whatever. It was
back then. What can you do?
I guess you were just saying how much we like when Dean Ambrose came out in a bear costume. Yeah. But this had no, I had no background to this. So I'm just like, this is random and I don't like it.
Yeah.
So then we move on to Mae Young is in the backstage. We have a little promo where she's getting a girl ready for a cat fight. And it's a gag about the girl. She's naked and they keep putting like things in front of her. So like she pulls out like a shirt that has like a pussycat and she goes, look at this shirt with a pussycat. And then they hold it up in front of her like lady parts down below.
Yeah.
And you know, they're doing it's a so bunch bad. Of really 90s WWF like gags about that. Like,
yeah.
Pretty ridiculous. But then we move on and we have Michael Cole, who's the interview bot.
Yeah.
This is before his time, I think, as
a commentator.
But he's an interview bot and he's doing an interview with the Dudleys, who have a match later coming up. Good. Dudley's always do good with promos. It was a good promo. Very intense. Very good. Next, we had the match Edge and Christian versus the Hardys versus the Dudleys. It was a ladder match for the tag team championships. Mm-hmm. Always good. These three teams.
I feel like that one definitely lived up to it. I mean, yeah, like you said, that was the first good match
that we saw.
Pre, like, tables, ladders, and chairs, but mm-hmm. they still did these, like, huge spots where, like, they were, like, you kind of said, like, setting up the stage, where you know the fall is going to happen.
You always,
like,
see things being placed perfectly.
Yeah.
And then we had, you know, the Swanton bomb from the top through a table.
Classic.
We had, I think Jeff Hardy was running somewhere and got smacked right in the face with a ladder, which was super awesome. These three teams go hardcore when they get together. Yeah,
they always just stellar.
So it ended with a cool spot where they made a little bridge with a table on top of two ladders where the tag team titles were. Edge and Christian got up there pretty much and pushed, I think, Devon Dudley off the top.
No, Matt Hardy, I think.
Was it Matt Hardy?
It was Matt Hardy.
It was someone pushed off the top, fell through a table. Edge and Christian grabbed the belts. They win. Cool. Next, we had Mick Foley with Linda McMahon doing a promo. So
yeah.
Linda McMahon had Mick Foley come back for this match. That was her endorsement.
Yeah.
Mick Foley did a great promo. He always does great promos.
And they were promoting it like this was the last match he was ever going to be a part of.
I think he had already retired and he came back for his last match. I mean, and he's been back multiple times since
then. So it's like an Undertaker
type
thing.
Yeah, no one ever fully retires until literally you're so debilitated you can't get in the ring. Even Undertaker is at the point of being debilitated.
If Vince McMahon still gets in there and lets Kevin Owens beat him up, I don't know if anybody's ever too...
Seriously, they can always bring someone back. Exactly. Just pull them out of their coffin and bring them in.
Yeah.
Next, we had the cat fight. So Val Venus was the special guest referee.
Horrible.
Terrible. So bad. I hate
literally how... made a bunch of sexual innuendos and stuff and then was just like... It was so bad.
Like, I get it's funny in the context of, like, if you're watching a movie or something. Like, it's funny humor, but I'm like, I just hate watching that stuff, just knowing where the women's division is now and how, like, they're not objectified anymore and they are some of the best athletic people on the roster.
Yeah.
And, like, back then, it was literally just them in high heels and panty and bras, like, catfighting for the most part.
Yeah.
Like, it was how much boob can we have hanging out of our thing without boobs actually falling out?
Well, I mean, there was a point where literally they were just making out with the refs.
Yeah,
and then they
started.
Were like tearing each other's clothes off. I'm like, this is literally no athleticness.
No.
Just for, like, the men in the audience to be like, wow, I wish I could be that ref.
Yeah. So essentially, it was stupid. Mae Young was promoting one of the girls. The Fabulous Moolah was promoting the other. So they were like,
which is interesting with all the controversy going on now.
And now we have the Mae Young Classic and the Fabulous Moolah Battle Royal and everything. And all the controversy you're talking about with Fabulous Moolah and all that. But essentially, Mae Young and Fabulous Moolah got in there. It got a DQ because one of them hit
and
one of the people.
And did their finisher.
And then
Mae
Young did, like, the Bronco Buster to Fabulous Moolah. Yeah. Pretty much ended there.
Pretty much.
Next, we had the Radicals versus China and Too Cool. So the Radicals were Eddie Guerrero and two people I didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
Benoit was part of the Radicals back then, but
he wasn't there.
He had a match later. And then it was China and Too Cool, which... was Scotty Too Hotty and someone else, and I don't remember who. So they had their match. Another one where I was just kind of like, whatever about. China pinned Eddie Guerrero. There was a lot of storyline going on about Eddie Guerrero thinking China was flirting with him and all this and that. I don't know.
Which, I mean, really... little side note, like, I loved China when I was younger. Like, mm-hmm. I would want to dress like her. I had all her, like, action figures and stuff. And then I think when I was probably, like, 16 and I went back and watched it, I was like, wow, like, she does not look like I remembered her. Like, she was really buff. Like, she was like the size of Triple H, it looked like.
Mm-hmm.
And then watching it now, I'm like, around 2000 she looked very trim.
Yeah,
like
she
was
out.
Definitely muscular, but she was not like the 90s silent Triple H.
She was probably like, what, like, Charlotte is right now.
Yeah, she looked great. Yeah. I mean, Jordan and I were kind of joking, like, whoever did her boob job was probably not feeling
her
too good.
Like,
but
they were scared of each other.
Yeah, but I'm like, you know, she was awesome in the ring too.
She was great. She was probably the best part of that match. Like, she had a wardrobe malfunction where her pants literally ripped on the top. So, like, they weren't, and she was still able to do all her spots. Like, she
without taking her clothes off.
She did a slam press on Eddie Guerrero. Like, great stuff. I think a moonsault was in there.
Yeah, she was awesome.
It was all good. And we were also talking because it's been a while since we've watched Eddie Guerrero fight.
Yeah.
We both were kind of like, wow, he was a pretty like jacked dude. His biceps were huge. I remember him being more like cruiserweight status.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know if he just gained a lot of weight around that time, but like he was looking pretty hefty.
Well, then Jordan and I were thinking, like, we knew that he passed away from a heart complication, but we were trying to figure out, was it ever like a thing that he was on such mass amount of steroids that that's what caused it? Because he looked really large.
He looked way bigger than I remember. Yeah, so that was kind of interesting to see that like our perception of Eddie Guerrero was completely different than
he did. Awesome though,
he did great. Him and China,
he
were
definitely
great.
Lived up to it.
I mean, it was cool. You got to see Scotty Too Hotty do the worm, which is like whatever. Mm-hmm. It's always fun.
Yeah,
those little gimmicky things are always really fun. Next, we moved in to another promo. Shane McMahon has the Big Show as his advocate for the Fatal 4-Way match. And the Big Show is like the most 90s shirt on I've ever seen. Like the font is 90s. Like it was ridiculous.
How tight, yeah, the little tank top just, that guys used
to wear.
It
was very funny how 90s all this stuff
Which,
looked.
I mean, again, when Jordan and I went back and watched it, we thought the Big Show was big then. But then you see him now and you're like, wow, like he looks so ripped and small in comparison. It's kind of like looking at The Rock, seeing how he is now. You're like, you thought they were in prime physical condition then.
No. Yeah. The Rock.
18 years later.
Yeah, exactly. These people just put on the pounds and like muscle. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. So next we had a Kurt Angle promo. And it's funny because Kurt Angle, I always, because now he's back as general manager on Raw. And I keep making fun of him because he's really bad at talking. He stumbles over his words a lot. He's not very fluid. He says really random things. Like, I forget what he said that one time, but we kept joking. He said, like, someone's name wrong. Ooh. Hold on, people.
He said Stephanie McRan.
Yeah, Stephanie McRan. And we're like, who's the McRan family? I don't know who they are. But this promo, fluid, like, perfect, like crisp and clean. His voice.
Yeah,
like,
we went back and watched his whole documentary, and it's like there was a lot of bad stuff going on behind the scenes. That stuff messes with you.
Yeah,
so.
He went through a lot of stuff, I guess, and had to do rehab. And I mean, that does mess with you and everything. But yeah, prime Kurt Angle. It was great. So he came out for a match where it was Chris Jericho versus Benoit versus Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle held both the European and the Intercontinental Championship, so he was a double champion. And he was defending both of them. So it was a two pinfall type thing where the first person to get a pinfall or submission wins the Intercontinental title, and then the second person wins European. Benoit pinned Jericho first. So Kurt Angle lost the Intercontinental title to Benoit. And then later, Jericho pinned Benoit for the European title, which means Kurt Angle was never pinned or submitted, but lost both his titles in that. So he was very, very frustrated, obviously. But that was a great match. You have three amazing people in their prime. Chris Benoit, and Kurt Angle. Because
the thing is, I mean, it's just personal preference, but a lot of times I don't like the odd man matches because one man is always left out or just doesn't seem fluid. But these guys knew how to do it. It was really good.
Yeah, no, they did a great job. Spots were clean. Everything was great. Next, we had a Vince McMahon promo. His advocate was The Rock. But as you know, The Rock wasn't there for this promo because, you know, The Rock got better things to do than sit there with Vince McMahon.
Promos.
He does his own promos. So Vince McMahon kind of talked a little bit. Then we went back to the ring. We had X-Pac and the Road Dogg. They were part of DX at the time. Mm-hmm. They were going against Rikishi and Kane. I don't know why the heck Kane was like a part of like Too Cool or like allying himself with them. But Kane won with the pin. I think he pinned Road Dogg. I don't remember. But then...
Oh, you didn't know?
Oh, I didn't know. Exactly. Very good. That's why I love her. So after they won, all of Too Cool came out, and they started doing this weird dance thing, and this like guy in a chicken costume came out and was dancing with them.
So random.
Yeah.
You got to give it to the 90s for spontaneity.
Yeah. Super random. And then there was this whole thing about Paul Bearer and Kane like sitting in the corner, and Kane was like contemplating maybe like dancing with them. But then randomly Pete Rose came out, and then Kane choke slammed him. I don't remember there being this weird Pete Rose thing with WrestleMania. Like, I guess they were like, this is the third time Pete Rose has been at WrestleMania and he keeps getting beat up or something. I'm like, I don't remember.
So maybe
this.
The recaps really are necessary.
Yeah, because they didn't do recaps at all. No, like we were talking, they did no recap promos before anything. Where no. I'm like, the one time I'd like it, so I know what the heck is going on. Nothing.
Yeah.
So then we had The Rock do his own promo because, like we said, The Rock's not going to allow Vince McMahon to be taking up screen time with him to do his promo. And of course, Rock does a great promo. That's why he's in Hollywood now. He's a great speaker. He's very effective. He's very energetic. And that leads us into the main event. First, Mick Foley comes out, Big Show, then The Rock, and then finally Triple H makes his way to the ring as WWF Championship. Me and Madison were both saying how boring it was seeing Triple H come out to music other than the game.
Yeah.
Music. And when he did his little spit thing, not having that like breakdown, like thing, like waiting for it to drop, was so anticlimactic. It looked so dumb.
I mean, also you have to throw in the fact like the entrances in the 90s were much different. Like, yeah, you take the pyro out of it now, but it's a much bigger production. Oh, and I was thinking, even like when they came out, the background is like highlights of them. Yeah. And now it's like artistic artwork.
Well, now they have the ramp. Very different. The ramp has like screens in it with stuff going on.
If you
want to
talk about a dramatic ramp, let's just talk about WrestleMania last year. Gosh. That was ridiculous. It was the length of a football field.
Yeah, it had so much stuff going on in it too. Like they tried to have that snake while Randy Orton was coming out and it was like, glitchy
whole
way down.
That's the time when you need to kind of revert back to how it was in the 90s.
And then it was funny too because it's so on the nose when they started doing the burn it down thing for Seth Rollins and like it was all fire on the ramp. And I'm like, man, he really likes fire now, huh?
Yeah.
It's like sometimes it's cool, but for the most part, it's like just ridiculous what they do with it. My favorite was always when Baron Corbin, before they changed his theme music and it used to be like the kind of apocalyptic wasteland.
Yeah,
thing.
I remember.
I liked how like the cloud came in and it came up the ramp and everything. Yeah. So sometimes they do some stuff that's cool, but sometimes it still looks
it's a little
just
forced.
Like very like yeah, very cheesy.
Yeah.
But anyway, the match is a no disqualifications elimination match. So we start off, the first elimination is the Big Show. The Rock does a rock bottom to him and he gets eliminated pretty early in the match. I think 5 minutes.
It was really quick. Yeah. I remember I kind of dozed off and when I came back up, he was already gone.
Yeah, it was very, very quick because this was like a 35-minute match.
Yeah.
I think from bell to bell, it was like 25 or 28 minutes. But I think from first entrance music to the very end, it was about 45 minutes. But there was a lot of stuff going on around it too, but we'll get to that in a sec. So then, next, Triple H eliminates Mick Foley with a chair shot.
Wait, hold on. Time out. You say Mick Foley.
Mick Foley, right?
Yeah, it's Mick Foley.
Well, I mean, don't point out my follies on the word Foley. Come on.
Wah, wah.
Wah, wah. I'm not as good as you didn't know. I can't top that one. I'm just going to stop trying the humor here.
Okay, we'll see how long that lasts.
Yeah, right. So Triple H, he hits Mick Foley with a chair shot to the head. Actually protected chair shot. Mick Foley got the hands up, which...
Well, if he was already retired by that point, he'd got a pretty significant beating by that point.
He didn't have enough brain cells to give up anymore. So chair shot, then Triple H pedigrees him onto the chair, pin. There we go. So now it's just Triple H and The Rock.
Which is classic. They're both some of my favorites.
Oh, yeah. But before Mick Foley leaves, he pulls out barbed wire wrapped around a 2x4 and hits Triple H over the head with it. And what I thought was funny was that there was no blood. Like,
I think
he didn't
it was
bleed.
The opposite, though. Mick Foley came in with the barbed wire and Triple H like backed up, hit him in the crotch.
But that
crotch
was earlier in the match.
Okay,
so the barbed wire
later.
Was introduced then, but the barbed wire didn't actually be utilized until this point in the match.
It was just
chilling out on the side of the ring. So this was the first time someone got hit with it. So Triple H got hit with it. And you would think barbed wire, very sharp, no bleeding. Your first clue that it's probably not barbed wire, you know, like there's no way he wouldn't be bleeding after getting hit in the head like that. But I'm kind of glad because the hardcore match had so much blood.
So much blood.
Let's try and keep this a little bit less bloody. And I think they were right at that point too, where they were kind of transitioning between like, how crazy are we supposed to get? And I think they were probably in talks with acquiring ECW at some point in the future. So they probably wanted to keep things separate. You know, ECW is the more extreme one and everything. But I mean, I'm making that up. I don't know the actual time frames. Like, I just remember that when WWF became WWE shortly after, there was like an ECW revival and all that. But Next, there was, so Triple H and The Rock fought for a while. There was a really cool spot where Triple H got on the steel steps, and he did a really cool kind of pile driver to The Rock on the steel steps. And I was like, I like that kind of stuff. Scares me, but I know for a fact that because we're watching this is way old, that like The Rock didn't get hurt during the smash. So I'm like, okay, I'm not as nervous as I would be watching this live for that spot to happen. But then Shane comes back down and he starts beating up his dad, Vince, and busts him open. Of course, the McMahons are the ones that have to start bleeding. So now Shane beat up Vince. Vince then has to be helped out back, but Shane stays ringside for some reason. I understand that they're like, I think the rest of the McMahon family hates The Rock, and Vince is the only one who liked The Rock. But then Vince came back down again and started beating Shane up. So you got this dual storyline kind of going where The Rock and Triple H are fighting, but then you have Shane and Vince kind of going back and forth fighting on the side of the ring. And then the actual match spills out to the side. I think The Rock does a suplex to Triple H through the announce table because
we Spanish can, announce
table. Yeah, we can table. Never make it to the end without the Spanish announce table getting destroyed. Bunch of shenanigans start going on, people fighting all over the place. It's an OGDQ match, so it doesn't really matter. Then we get to this pivotal moment where The Rock, I think, does like a rock bottom or something. So they're like, Rock's going to pin Triple H and win. Well, Vince takes a chair and hits The Rock, who's his endorsement.
Right.
And for some reason hits The Rock. And so Triple H goes to pin The Rock, and The Rock actually kicks out after getting hit in the head with a chair. So everyone's like, oh my gosh. And then Vince hits him a second time with the chair, and then that's when Triple H pins him. And essentially what happens is that the Vince and Stephanie and Shane all for some reason come together and are happy that they screwed over The Rock, even though Shane and Vince were just fighting a second ago and they kept Triple H in power. But then as The Rock was leaving, the crowd starts throwing trash into the ring, which is very old school. Like, you would not get away with
like
that
NWO
now.
Stuff. Oh,
yeah. It was awesome. Like, I'm like, I like this. Like, that part is cool to me. Like,
yeah, because
that disaster.
No matter how fake the storyline is, the crowd's reaction is genuine.
Oh, yeah. And you could tell the crowd. Like, the crowd now is more informed and more organized in the sense that they do a lot of chants that are things that you know going into it. You're part of this community. Yeah, like, the what chants, the, like, 1-2 sweet chants.
Yeah.
The deleted
there's a lot
chants.
Of them.
Like, everyone kind of knows the woos from Ric Flair. I didn't hear a lot of chanting going on.
No. Yeah, like you said, it wasn't as organized.
No, like people, it was way more of a ruckus the whole time.
It's but more
people,
like cheering or booing.
Yeah, but people weren't chanting in unison like they do now. But yeah, so trash gets starts being thrown into the ring. The Rock comes back and he gives a rock bottom to Shane. Then he gives one to Vince. And then Stephanie gets in there and starts yelling at him, which she hadn't gotten the full Stephanie McMahon mean face yet.
She's perfected
she
now.
She really didn't get to the McMahon level yet, but she slaps The Rock. Rock ain't having it. He's like, hey, gender equality. Gives her a rock bottom.
Yep.
Not just a rock bottom, but gives her a people's elbow just for good measure. And then pretty much it ends with a recap video package of the whole night, which I'm sure in the year 2000, that was like huge. We're like, we could have a recap video of everything we just shot. It's going to be amazing. People are going to be like, how'd you get that out so quick? So, and then it just cuts to black then after that. And that's the whole thing. So for the most part, I feel like it wrecked both our perceptions because we remember this like just raw emotion and it being so physical, and now it just looks janky and unproduced and underwhelming. And apart from three matches in the whole card, we were like, yeah, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I think you started making cookies at one point
because we're
like, we need something to get us through these like terrible filler matches through most of this. So yeah, it was fun watching a few of it, but for the most part it felt more like a chore. I think it's something to be said that you're right. You pick and choose those matches that you want to rewatch, and that's pretty much all you want to do for nostalgia. And the only reason why it's more fun to watch full pay-per-views now compared to old stuff is because those filler matches, you do actually know what's going on in the storylines. You're watching it consistently. You get where it is, where you go back and you watch it and you're like, hey, this guy I barely ever heard of, and this other guy who has a weird gimmick, they're fighting a guy in a chicken suit. Like,
yeah, and to be fair, in 20 years we can go back and watch this year's WrestleMania and the filler ones, we can be like, wow, this is really bad. 20
years from now, we'll go back and watch this year's WrestleMania and be like, man, they did a lot to get Roman Reigns that title.
Oh gosh.
They've been working on that for a real
other
time.
Podcast in and of itself.
I mean, I'm slowly being won over by Roman right now, only because they're letting him do some shoot style work, like not real shoot style, but feeling like shoot style, mm-hmm. and they're letting him be a little bit more emotional. But yeah, it's just that's gonna be for the time frame we're in now, that's gonna be the infamous thing. Like, it used to be the pipe bomb CM Punk stuff was like a few years back. This time frame is gonna be the when they really wanted Roman Reigns to get over. But yeah, so that was WrestleMania 16. We watched it. That's what I have to say about that, and that's about it. So you have anything you want to add to that?
No, I think we pretty much covered it. I still think, like, even though it wrecked my perception, that I would definitely still want to go back and watch like the other WrestleManias, mm-hmm. like the one with the Undertaker and McFoley match where he like falls on the pins and stuff. Yes. Like, because I normally go back and only watch that match, but it would be interesting to watch the whole thing from start to finish and mm-hmm. see if that's also the same one, because I don't remember that match looking janky. Like, I remember that match being very, even though there were some flukes in it where he like fell through when he wasn't supposed to and stuff, like, it was still very nice.
Well, it's here and looking. There because like the Chris Jericho, Chris Benoit, Kurt Angle match it looked well produced. It looked on point. I think it's because at the year 2000, you had this overlap of the new stars coming in who were like a lot more effective in what they were doing. Like, they trained a very different style than the Road Dogg, Al Snow, X-Pac, these older guys who were there who had been in it since like the early 90s. Now these guys coming in the late 90s, like as they come in, they just up the ante a little bit more. And you have this like slight crossover here where these guys look old school, these guys look new school, and there's a vast gap between them. Mm-hmm. So I think that's part of the problem of that as well. But yeah, it would be interesting to go back and watch some other ones just to see like how well they did and if our memory was really kind of helping fudge out those bad spots or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, until next time, we'll see you later.